Hey guys, welcome to yet another interesting session by Intellipaat. And today we are going to discuss about Apache Spark. In today's session, we will cover why Apache Spark, what is Apache Spark versus Hadoop, different features of Apache Spark, Spark architecture and its components, career opportunities, and a hands-on exercise. Now let us look at a use case of Spark. One of the world's leading and pioneering e-commerce giant is eBay, which facilitates both business-to-business and business-to-consumer sales. eBay is a marketplace with 162 million active customers and 25 million sellers. So eBay wanted to make their data as efficient as possible for the buyers and sellers, as they have a total of 800 million listings on their site and 8.8 million new listings are being added every week. So initial user pattern of eBay was search oriented, in which the users had to search through the listings to find the products. With the transition in e-commerce, the users just wanted to browse and buy the products instead of searching in the list. To do this, eBay had to transition their entire data model. Initially, eBay was using Hadoop architecture, which was not compatible with the real-time data model. Hence, eBay was looking for a more real-time architecture tool. Well, Apache Spark was a handy tool for them. eBay uses Apache Spark to provide offers to targeted customers based on their earlier experiences and tries to leave no stone unturned in enhancing the customer experience. This enhances the customer experience in providing what they might require in a proactive manner and also helps them to efficiently and smoothly handle customers' time on the e-commerce side. eBay does this magic by letting Apache Spark leverage through Hadoop yarn. So what is Apache Spark? Do you have any idea what it is? Apache Spark is an open source engine developed specifically for handling large scale data processing and analytics. The large amounts of unstructured data and the need for increased speed to fulfill the real-time analytics have made this technology a real alternative for big data computational exercises. When it comes to real-time data analytics, Spark stands as the go-to tool compared to all other solutions. Now you might be wondering, when we already have Hadoop to process the data, why do we need Spark? So let us see what makes Spark more popular than Hadoop. To answer this, we have to look at the concept of batch and real-time processing. Batch processing is nothing but collecting the data over a period and processing it. For example, payroll and billing system. In case of real-time processing, the data collection and processing occurs at the same time. You can think of ATM as an example of a real-time system. As soon as you enter your password and other details, you will receive the desired amount. Hadoop is based on the concept of batch processing, where the processing happens on blocks of data that is already being stored over a period. However, Spark can process data in real time and it is 100 times faster than Hadoop MapReduce for batch processing large datasets. One more advantage of Spark is it can deal with both historical and real time data. Over here, we clearly see the major differences between Hadoop and Spark. With Spark, you can handle multiple applications based on both historical and real-time data. Spark is also easy to use and has a faster processing engine when compared to Hadoop. Now let us look at some of the features of Spark. Spark code can be developed in Java, Scala, Python, or R language. Spark runs 100 times faster than MapReduce. Spark supports different data sources like text, CSV, RDBMS, JSON, Hive, and Cassandra. Spark provides real-time computation. Spark also supports machine learning. So now we'll move on to the Spark architecture. The Spark architecture includes the driver program, cluster manager, and various worker nodes. The driver is the central entry point of the Spark shell. It runs the main function of the application and creates a Spark context. The driver stores the metadata about all the resilient distributed databases and their partitions. Cluster manager is responsible for acquiring resources on the Spark cluster and allocating them to a Spark job. So there are three different types of cluster managers a Spark application can leverage for the allocation and deallocation of various physical resources. The executor is a distributed agent responsible for the execution of tasks. Spark application has its own executor process. Executors usually run for the entire lifetime of a Spark application, and this phenomenon is known as static allocation of executors. Let us understand how Spark runs. Apache Spark runs in three different ways: standalone, on Hadoop yarn, and Spark and MapReduce. The simplest deployment of Spark is standalone, in which a Hadoop cluster is equipped with all resources statically and runs in parallel with MapReduce. Spark can also be executed on top of YARN without any pre-installation. Now, even though if you don't have YARN, you can also use Spark along with MapReduce. This reduces the burden of deployments. Anyway, when Spark is deployed, the configuration allocates it the necessary resources. The moment Spark is connected, it obtains executors on the node. These executors are nothing but the processes running computations and securing the data. Now the application code is sent to the executor. Let's now look at the Spark components that make up the Spark ecosystem. Apache Spark Core is the fundamental processing engine of the Spark application. Its most important features include in-memory processing and data referencing from external data sources. Spark Streaming displays its high-speed computational prowess. It works excessively well with streaming data for providing real-time data analytics. The data is segregated into multiple batches, and using the RDD abstraction, the data is processed in a massively parallel fashion iteratively to suit the needs of stream data processing. Spark SQL creates a new level of data abstraction called the Schema RDD for working exclusively with both structured and semi-structured data by deploying SQL. GraphX is graph processing capability of Apache Spark framework that is the amalgamation of iterative graphical computation, exploratory analysis, and ETL capabilities. Spark can also be used for machine learning algorithms and applications using its MLlib library that provides a machine learning framework for Spark in a memory-based distributed environment. So these features of Spark have been rapidly adopted by enterprises cutting across a wide range of industries. Internet powerhouses such as Netflix, Facebook, and eBay have deployed Spark at massive scales. It has quickly become the largest open source community in big data, with over 1,000 contributors from 250 plus organizations. PayPal also uses Spark technologies to manage and process its large-scale data. Being a closed-loop payment platform, it processes billions of data events every day around users, risk payments, web behavior, and identity. To help the merchants in maximizing the number of successful transactions, they had to use data processing solutions. Well, Spark plays a major role in that and helps PayPal to process large-scale data to enable impactful merchant solutions. Now, let us go on to the hands-on exercise. So we'll be implementing the Spark SQL on top of the Diamonds dataset. Now I'll be using PuTTY to execute the practical. So let me directly head on to Spark shell. So I'll type Spark shell over here. Now we have entered the Spark shell, and the version of Spark that I'm using is 2.3.1. And since I have to work with Spark SQL, let me go ahead and import the package. So I'll type import org.apache.spark.sql.sql context. So I've successfully imported SQL context. Now it's time to create a new SQL context object. I'll do that now. So I'll say val of SQL context new, and I'll pass in the Spark context parameter over here. So now I have the SQL context object. And with this, I can import the Diamonds dataset. So let me go ahead and import it. I am storing the results in Diamonds object. So over here, I'll say SQL context dot read dot format. That is, I'm specifying the format of the file. This is a CSV file. So I'll type out CSV over here. Now we'll go ahead and give some options. So the first option would be, I need to enable infer schema to be true. Now I'm doing this because whenever we import CSV files into Spark, all of the columns are taken to be string. And if you want their true data types of the columns, then we need to say infer schema is true. Now similarly, I want the header to be true as well. So I'll say header as the first parameter. This need to be an option. So option of header is And now it's finally time to load the file. So I'll give the path of the file over here. So this is stored in training spark data. So now I have loaded the diamonds dataset and also stored it in diamonds object. Let me go ahead and have a glance at the dataset. I can do that using the show function. Now we need to keep in mind that this is a data frame over here. This is not an SQL table. This is a data frame. So this is a diamonds dataset and these are the columns. So caret gives us the weight of the diamond. This is the quality of the cut. Then we have color of the cut, clarity of the cut. Then we have depth, table, price of the diamond in US dollars, and length, width, and depth of the diamond in millimeters. Right. Now, let's go ahead and create this table. So what we can do is diamond dot, and I'll register a temporary table. So I'll say diamond dot register temp table, and I'll name this table as TIA. So we have successfully created our table. Now we can run all of our SQL queries on top of this DIA table. So let's go ahead and perform our first Spark SQL query. Do that, we need to use SQL context.sql, and I want to see all of the records of this data set. So I'll say select star from DIA, and I need to show the result. So now the difference over here is this DIA is a table, and when we used diamonds.show, that was a data frame. Right now, we'll go ahead and implement some other SQL operations. Now, I'd want to find out the maximum price of the diamond, the minimum price of the diamond, and average price of the diamond. So let me go ahead and do that. So again, SQL context.sql, and over here, I'll type select maximum of price from DIA dot show. So the maximum price of the diamond in this data set is $18,823. Now similarly, we can also find the minimum price of this diamond. All I need to do is use the min function from SQL. So the minimum price of the diamond in this data set is $323. Now let me go ahead and find the average. I can use the AVG function for that. And the average price of the diamond is this, $3,932. Now I'll use some special SQL queries and create three data frames out of these. So the first data frame would contain all of those diamonds whose price is greater than 15,000. The second data frame will contain diamonds whose price is in between 5,000 and 15,000. And the third data frame will contain only those diamonds whose price is less than 5,000. So let me go ahead and run those SQL queries. So now I'd want to find out those diamonds whose price is greater than 15,000. And I'll store that result in, let's say, high price. Now let me run the SQL query over here. Again, I'll use SQL context for that. So I'll say SQL context dot SQL select star from DIA, which is our table, where we are using the where clause over here, where price is greater than 15,000. Now we have our high price data frame.
Let us have a glance at this data frame. So I'll say high price dot show. Let us look at the price column over here. Now we see that all of the prices are greater than 15,000. Now, similarly, let me create another data frame and I'll name this data frame to be medium price, because we are taking all those diamonds whose price is less than 15,000 and greater than. So we are using the AND clause over here, and the price is greater than 5,000. Now let me have a glance at this as well. So I'll say medium price dot show. Right, so we see that this is the price range from 5,000 to 15,000. Now it's time to create a new data frame which contains only those diamonds whose price is less than 5,000. So I'll name this to be low price. And over here, the price needs to be less than 5,000. So this is our data set. Again, I'll say low price dot show. Let me have a glance at this. Right. So as we see over here, this is the minimum price diamond, and this ranges from 326 to 5,000. Let us go ahead and find out the count of all of these three data frames. So to do that, let's say high price dot count HIGH. So as we see, there are 1655 diamonds whose price is greater than 15,000. Now let us find out the count of the medium price diamonds. So there are 13,058 diamonds whose price is between 5,000 and 15,000. Similarly, let me change this to low price now. So there are 39,213 diamonds whose price is less than 5,000. Now, as we see, the most count is of the diamonds whose price is less than 5,000. Right. So this was a demo which helped you to understand the implementation of Spark SQL. Now let us head back to our PPT. Now let us look at the career opportunities in Spark. So isn't Spark doing a great job? Also, it is a fact that Apache Spark developers are among the highest paid programmers in the Hadoop framework as compared to 10 other Hadoop development tools. As per a recent survey by O'Reilly Media, it was evident that having Apache Spark skills under your belt can give you a hike in salary, and also mastering Scala programming can give you a further jump in your annual salary. This is the best time to start your career in Spark. So what are you waiting for? Join our Apache Spark training today and become a Spark professional. So let us summarize what we have discussed in today's session. We have discussed about the eBay use case to understand the need of Spark. We also discussed Hadoop versus Spark, what is Spark, different components and features of Spark, and finally, we did a hands-on using Spark SQL. So thank you for watching this video. If you have any inquiries, feel free to contact us.
Thank you for watching the video. Do like and share it. If you have any questions, comment below and we'll respond to them as soon as possible. Also, do subscribe to Intellipaat channel so that you can keep yourself updated on the latest technologies. You can also go through other related videos in our playlist. And for more information, visit our website. Keep learning, keep improving.